Hey there, welcome to today's digital replay. Today we're doing Unit 1, the introduction, specifically pages 2 through 6 in your textbook, answering the question, what is science? Adam Savage of Mythbusters fame once said that the only difference between screwing around and science is writing it down. Adam, that's an awesome definition of science because we do some really goofy, weird things, fun, crazy things in science class, but maybe not the best definition for science in a science class. So in this class, we're going to define science with this phrase right here, a systematic investigation of nature. Now, this is one of those things that you should probably write down, and if it's something you should write down, I like to use the little note card icon up here in the top right-hand corner. You'll see those throughout the digital replays. Science is a systematic investigation of nature. That means that we have a step-by-step process, an orderly process of looking at, exploring, observing the world, okay? Measuring it, using, collecting data. We have some systematic way of doing that. All right, so that's the working definition we're going to use in this class. Hey, question, what do Johannes Kepler and a baby have in common? Curiosity. Both of these are naturally curious beings. Actually, you were naturally curious from birth. That's how you started out. You put stuff in your mouth. You were wondering if it was food. You know, you were curious. Is this something I can eat? Johannes Kepler, he was really big into looking at the sky and using telescopes and stuff, and he figured out a new way of putting together a telescope so he could see farther. Okay, now in both of the cases of the baby putting something in his mouth and Johannes Kepler pointing his telescope to the sky, they both were curious, and both those curiosities led to discovery because they took that curiosity, they made observations, they acted upon it, and it led to new discoveries. Some of them more profound than others, but hey. Hey, so I specifically picked Johannes Kepler, not because I have a crush on him or something, but because he looked at the sky. And in class, that's what we did. We looked at the sky. We actually used some observations of the sun and some shadows on Earth to make some inferences about what's going on between the Earth and the sun in space. In class, we went outside, we took a ring stand, a meter stick, and a protractor, we measured the height of the ring stand, we measured the length of the shadow, and we also measured the angle of that shadow, and recorded all this data into our laboratory notebook, which we took back to class. After we took our measurements, we came back to class, we put them all into a table, and we started to look at them. This is what scientists do. They take the data and they look at it, okay? So we've got all of these points of data, and right away some things start to become apparent. You look in the shadow length column, for example. We got 49, 51, 51, 50, 19. What? This right away throws up red flags. We were all using the exact same kind of ring stand. We were doing this at the same time of day. Where is this 19 coming from? Well, if you look right next to it, it has the letters IN. That means this 19 is in inches. If you look at all the other ones, centimeters, 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 centimeters. All of the other ones are in centimeters. There's one that is in inches. Oops. It's important as a scientist to use the same units as other scientists, okay? We use the International System of Measurements, or SI. That's really important because this data point looks wrong. It looks wrong here. It's not 19 centimeters, it's 19 inches, and that's just, whoa, all messed up, okay? The next thing that stands out is that all of these numbers here are between 0 and 5, except for this one. So all of the shadow angle is between 0 and 5, except for this one. This one is 10, which is way out there. It is possible that when we were setting it up, somebody did not quite use and align the compass directly north. It is important to use your measurement tools correctly because when you don't, you get these outlying points of data. You get this erroneous data. Okay? That's a source of error, is a misused tool. Okay? Very, very important. The other thing that's also important to do is to use multiple points of data. Use the multiple points of data because you don't know which one is right. You don't know which ones are wrong. We want a nice average. It's somewhere in the range of this, right? So that's why we use the multiple points of data. It helps us reduce the amount of error. Okay, so after the entire day passes, we took all of the data each period and averaged it, okay? So now I have some shadow lengths for period one, which is in the morning, a shadow angle for period one, et cetera, for each of the 6 periods, right? And we looked at this in class. Now, here were some of the observations we were able to make in class. We started in the morning around 298 degrees. The shadow was pointing in the sort of west northwest direction, right? That's where the shadow was pointed. Okay. Throughout the day, we were able to see that the shadow has a path that goes kind of from west to east. The shadow has a path that goes from west to east. Now we know a little bit about shadows, and what we know is that the sun has to be opposite whichever way the shadow is pointing. So we know that if the shadow was going from west to east, we know that the sun would have to be opposite wherever the shadow was, right? So the sun was traveling, it appeared to be traveling across our sky from east to west. Okay? It appeared to be traveling from east to west. Hey, that was something that we actually could observe and make observations about in class. During class, I mean, this is cool. We're actually able to see some motion of planetary bodies. This is insane. This is a little animation that I found online. It's mostly for kids, but I like it because it's easy to see what's happening. It's easy to show you what's going on in the observations that we've made. So here we are at the beginning of the day. The sun is low in the sky. The shadow is long. You notice that if the sun is low in the sky, we have long shadows at an angle that exactly is 180 degrees from the sun. Exactly. So as the sun moves through the sky, that shadow has to remain exactly opposite the sun. Has to remain exactly opposite the sun. The higher the sun goes in the sky, the shorter the shadow. So what we can do with the shadow data we collected is we can make inferences about the path of the sun in the sky based on A, the length of the shadow will tell us how high or low the sun is, and B, the angle of the shadow can tell us the angle of the sun, or where it is in the north, south, east, west, where it is on the compass rose. This path is something we can measure. The path of motion of the sun is something we can measure just by looking at shadows. This segues perfectly to modeling. So we have some different models that I showed in class. The first is this stationary Earth model, where the Earth is stationary and the Sun actually moves around the Earth. Every 24 hours, it makes this revolution around the entire Earth. So the Earth stays still and the Sun goes around it. And you can see if we have this Sun that's moving, you can see from the video we have this long, short, long. The shadowing effect is exactly the same as what we observed outside. So this model works with our observations. The second model is if we had a stationary sun, but the Earth is actually moving around the sun. And again, this would be every 24 hours because in the data we saw the long, short, long of the shadow and the angle of the shadow change. So every 24 hours, this Earth would go all the way around the sun. Now, the third model is that the Earth is actually like a top rotating on its axis, and as it rotates on its axis, we see that long, short, long shadowing effect. The angle of the shadow is changing. We see this from our data. So this model again matches our data. So we have three models, and we have to take our observations of Earth and what's going on in the sky, and we can choose which model works best. lot to throw at you the first week, but here's what I wanted you to get from it. Science is a systematic investigation of nature. It's a way we go step by step. We observe, we take measurements, we take data, and those observations can lead to discoveries about our natural world. Now, remember also that how we make observations can sometimes be more important than the observations themselves, meaning like don't use your tool incorrectly. Ask for help if you need to. Okay? Hey, this has been your digital replay for Unit 1, the first section of Unit 1. We will see you next time.